Hey everyone, coming to you at long last from my dear sweet home of Los Angeles. And before we get into my chat with Landon Cider, I want to thank each and every one of you for the love and support that you extended to me during my recent illness. You really, really boosted my spirits, and that helped to make things not as scary as they would have been otherwise. And I'm essentially back to normal health-wise. I have to take a little extra care with my stomach for a few more months, but you know what? In light of what's going on in the world, it hardly matters. I just wanted to mention all of this so I could say once again, thank you all so, so much. And as I said, I'm in my apartment and I ain't leaving anytime soon. I hope that's the same for you. Now, anyone who has to leave your place because of work obligations or family obligations, etc., I'm wishing you all of the protection and care available and I send my love. Anyone else, please join me. Stay inside. But you know, if you're listening to this show, you know what's best already, and you're already inside. So hope you're enjoying yourself. And if you're not, if you're having some tough times, there are resources that you absolutely should be taking advantage of, okay? So if you are having some struggles, text the word home to 741741. That's a United States number. If you're in the UK, text shout to 85258. And if you're outside America or England, I'm sure a quick online search will reveal other resources similar to the ones I just mentioned. As many of you know, a lot of our friends are out of work right now, but thankfully there's a lot of things we can do to help ease that pain. So see what's going on with your favorite performers, especially your local queens, and find out if there's a Venmo or a Cameo account and OnlyFans, and then do what you can. If you can't afford financial support, try to boost their signal online. And speaking of online, you want to get into some hot online drag shows? Well, you're in luck, because on Friday the 20th, Biqtch Puddin is hosting the Digital Drag Show, featuring other friends of ours like Alaska, Bible Girl, Landon Cider, and so many more. Tune in to twitch.tv/Biqtch Puddin, that's B-I-Q-T-C-H-P-U-D-D-I-N, at 7 p.m. Pacific Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Time, and various times around the globe. West Hollywood legend Rhea Letre is also serving you some online shows on Mondays and Wednesdays, so head on over to her Instagram, which you're probably already following, but if you're not, find it at R-H-E-A-L-I-T-R-E for more info. And you can also check the episode description of this episode, and you will find links that will carry you away to the magic. And for bands and singers that you like, especially the independent ones, buy their records, buy their merch, whatever it is, because they can't tour right now. No one can. Basically, support the things that you love. Oh, and speaking of that, this episode is brought to you exclusively by patreon.com/Craig and Friends. That's right, patreon.com/Craig and Friends. Matter of fact, a lot of upcoming episodes will be brought to you solely by patreon.com/Craig and Friends, aka Hot Dog Club. You know, I got an email the other day about some sponsor shakeups with ad placements. Apparently, there's quite a few companies who don't know what to do right now in this current climate, and they're reshuffling and sometimes removing spots while they figure it out. So now is the absolute perfect time to head on over to patreon.com/Craig and Friends and become a patron. Because that way you'll be supporting the production of the show, and you'll be getting an ocean of exclusive full-length episodes. The $5 tier gets you the bonus episodes. But a sexier option by far, well, it's the $7 tier, in which you get the bonus episodes plus the listener questions episodes. Oh, but the sexiest, most sophisticated, and chic option? Well, that would be the $10 option. Because when you join at the $10 tier, you get the bonus episodes, the listener questions episodes, and you're welcomed into Movie Club. That's right, Movie Club, where you are a part of the deep discussion, dissection, and analysis of films like Casino, Hairspray, Suspiria, Romy and Michelle's High School Reunion, A Star is Born, Craig Russell's Outrageous. The list goes on and on and on. And Movie Club is fabulous, and I'm not just saying that because I know the guy who makes it. In addition to me, you get to hear episodes with people like Willem, Katya, Alaska, Bright Light, Bright Light, Jake Shears, John Grant, and coming soon to Movie Club, my friend and noted bisexual, Gabi Dunn. You're probably familiar with her Bad With Money podcast, her Just Between Us podcast and YouTube channel, and she's going to be joining me for the 1980 Jodie Foster and Cherie Curry classic, Foxes. Oh, but there's so much more. But you know what? We got a show to listen to. So head on over to patreon.com/Craig and Friends, sign up, and slide on in to the Thunderbuns of Hot Dog Club.
A Russian ballerina stomping on a bureaucrat. A perky suburban housewife who just got into scat. Give it a beep, boop, 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 bow, boop, boop, bow. It's whimsically volatile.
And let me just get a mic check on you, just on the level. Give me a couple words.
Hey. Rolling with the homies.
Perfect. Perfect. I think we got the show.
We're done. We're got it. Good.
Dear listeners, prepare yourself, because on this episode of Whimsically Volatile, I am pleased to present you a groundbreaking treasure of the many splendor drag world, a king amongst queens who strides into your hearts and minds as easily as the glitter rains down from his umbrella, the shape-shifting epitome of glamdrogeny. That's right, I'm speaking of the one, the only, the fierce, the fabulous, the pride of Long Beach, the reigning champion of Dragula, and my guest today, Landon Cider.
Oh, I love that so much.
Welcome. Thank you so much for coming over.
Honestly, the only reason why I decided to come on the show is because I couldn't wait to hear my intro. So,
well, again, you know, I thought we had the show done earlier. Now we got We're fully done.
Yeah,
we got two shows
actually
done.
Yeah.
Now, did you drive from Long Beach today?
I did.
Did you grow up in Long Beach?
No, LA all my life, mm-hmm. but I moved to Long Beach when I was around 23, 24.
Okay.
I've been there since.
Cool. Now, what brought you to Long Beach?
A roommate possibility.
Okay.
Because I was living on my own in a one-bedroom apartment after my mom died, and I was just kind of in Whittier, and I just kind of was lonely. I
sure.
had some friends say, hey, we're going to buy a house, but we can't really afford it to do it on our own, so we need a roommate. Do you want to be our roommate? And I mm-hmm. said, sure. And Long Beach was so gay, so I loved it already, so it was like an easy answer.
I just spent my first time in Long Beach recently for the Tammy Brown 20th anniversary gala.
Yeah. I didn't get to go to that, but it sounded like it was going to be great.
Well, and it's at your stomping grounds,
yeah,
right? Hamburger Mary's.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I couldn't believe how amazing that Hamburger Mary's is.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously, the WeHo one's great, but that one is unbelievable.
It is a stadium.
Yeah, it really
literally.
Is.
Literally.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, you could like drive a car through there.
Totally.
Yeah, I'm sure someone has, like at least a stunt car or something.
Something.
Yeah, something. Hopefully, maybe one day that'll be part of someone's number.
Like, they have a lot of rules at Hamburger Mary's when it comes to what you can perform, so.
Oh, do they? What are some of the rules?
Well, they have a certain licensing, like the cabaret style licensing, mm-hmm. so you can't show certain body parts, you can't even give a nude illusion of body parts, you can't have flame or powder or glitter or like all that shit that I break anyway.
But, okay. I was just about to ask, you must have run up against that.
I have. And I've encouraged artists when I bring them in, and I know they do some risque looks that are against the rules. I'm like, I want you to do it anyway. Just pretend like you didn't know.
You didn't hear them. It was loud.
Yeah. Oh man, I forgot.
So when did you start performing at Hamburger Mary's?
That was my home bar. So my very first performance was at Hamburger Mary's.
Oh, it was?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And what age were you when that happened?
28, somewhere in there, 2009.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Mm-hmm. And describe for me what that looked like. What was the song and what was the vibe?
It was a hot mess is what it looked like.
That's my favorite kind.
I looked like a lesbian in her brother's clothes.
Uh-huh.
As a overachiever, I did two numbers, and even being more of an overachiever, I did two mixes.
Whoa.
So I very, very amateurish style made a couple mixes, and the first one was my debut number, was a masked feminine presenting human body and a bunch of songs I don't remember because I smoke a lot of marijuana. That went from like, I think I had like The Gossip in there.
Oh, sure. Yeah. Yeah.
And then I don't even remember. I just really liked The Gossip. So I probably mm-hmm. performed to them, and it went through an evolution of this character of like, the storyline. Cause you know me in stories.
Sure.
Went from feminine presenting into kind of having like an evolution of finding himself.
Mm-hmm.
And I changed on stage from a dress into my brother's clothes. Mm-hmm. I don't even have a brother, which is really amazing ability to be able to do.
That you just happen to have those around too.
It's I mean,
the detail level that you're going
already,
through.
Already, right? That's my first number. God. And then it went into Freebird. I remember ending on Freebird, and I ripped off the mask and I just celebrated in my freedom, and my boobs came untaped and were bouncing around, and I was just holding my tits, celebrating my freedom. And then my other one was like a sexy, I'm gonna try to charm the pants off you kind of character, mm-hmm. which I still do often.
Yes, sure. Now, what would be the number done with that? What would be the song? I know you like Depeche Mode, right?
I do, but they didn't come into my repertoire for a while.
Okay.
I don't remember that one either. Mm-hmm. God, I'm not very good at this already, am I?
Well, I mean, look, I mean...
Just this is the entire interview.
You weren't supposed to get... This is it.
You're going to ask me details. You're going to ask me song titles. You're going to ask me a lot of things I'm not going to know the answer
to. Cool. That's cool. I'm going to try to find even more obscure things and stuff farther in the past.
And you're like such the opposite. You're like, you know, every title and every year and every detail and who wrote it and who produced it and how many people were on the crew. And I'm just like, I have no idea how
to answer. It's funny you bring that up, though, because I'm always fascinated with this. Everyone has a different style of memory.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and you are obviously much more of a visual memory person. And right. I know that there's classifications, and I'm not getting that right. I know that there's like probably definitions. Perfect, perfect. I think we should high five on that one. Right. And but I think that there's a bunch of different styles of like learning or memory or whatever. Mm-hmm. When looking at the incredible art that you do,
thank you.
You're welcome. The special effects makeup, as you describe it, which I think is a wonderful description, mm-hmm. and I want to get into that further in a minute, but. Looking at the level of detail and the emotion that I see even in the shading, that is something that would be far outside my grasp. And that speaks to a level of retention of detail and reference in a visual medium that would completely outstrip mine.
Okay.
And so that's what I love is that I feel like we all have these different, I guess like little Tron cars of memory on different tracks.
Oh, I love that.
Oh, good, good.
Yeah, I love that. Especially like the 80s reference. I was like, glow in the dark reference.
Right, exactly. Yeah, yeah. I'm glad I could pick something very topical yes. and relatable.
I'm happy that I knew the 80s decade that was involved in the Tron reference. So, yeah.
Are you fond of the 80s?
I am. Mm-hmm. Not so much in detail like we talked about, but I love.
No.
I was born in 80. So yeah. I had my early childhood is based in fluorescent colors and, you know, cheesy pop music.
Sure.
And then when I got older, I realized that there was a whole alternative side of the 80s that I was like, oh, I like this one so much better.
I know, it is crazy. Like, there's all that stuff, the fluorescent neon, and then there's, like, again, Depeche Mode.
Yeah.
All this other stuff going on at the same time.
Yeah.
I mean, there must be the similar things in every decade, but for some reason in the 80s, there's so much stuff.
MTV probably had a big movement with that.
Totally, because like Duran Duran wasn't really selling a lot in America, but MTV, people freaked out. Like Iowa suddenly flipped out over Duran Duran, which like wouldn't happen before.
That's
true. Guys in makeup like that.
Uh-huh, yeah.
Because like glam rock, you know, crashed and burned here before, but anyway.
Totally. Mm-hmm, like people were not ready.
But glamdrogeny, I love that phrase, and I've only, and you came up with that, right? That's your phrase.
I didn't come up with it. Okay. I did embrace it. It was something that I heard, as the kind of evolution of kings I was watching on social media start to evolve into more colorful makeups and things. And I was already playing with it, but I didn't know what to call it. And a few kings that I saw started to use that word. I'm like, oh, I like that word.
It's a great word.
And so definitely didn't come up with it, but I define myself almost by it now. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Now, when did you start playing around with makeup and the identities?
The identities came from growing up in acting and performing. Mm-hmm. But the makeup came in high school. I started playing with special effects stuff. And right out of high school, I was always purchasing the, like, throughout the year, I would go to the Halloween club. Mm-hmm. If you know the store here in Southern California, they have a few locations. And they're open all year long and they have intense everything you can think
of. Oh, sure. Like it's warehouse size.
Yeah. And this is before you could really just Amazon Prime shit, you know? So you actually go and put effort in or pay like $1,000 for like a VHS on how to apply things.
Totally.
Which was completely out of my my range financially.
Yeah. VHSs used to be outrageously expensive. Like insanely. It doesn't make any sense because also $100 in 1988 is like how much now?
Yeah. I know. Right? To me, probably like 15,000.
Yeah, same.
Almost, yeah. And so I would go and I buy the little special effects. And the one that I always reference when I tell this story is like the screwdriver going in and out of your face. So you have the end of it and then you have the other side and you would just kind of apply both sides to make it look visually like it was through your face.
Okay, sure.
And I bought that one. I bought a lot of them, but that's when I remember. And you look at the back and it says required items and then it said suggested items. So I would buy all of the items that it had on the back and I would figure out by process of elimination and fucking up my face and fucking up my hands, trying to figure out what these things did. And taught myself that way when it came to the special effects stuff.
Okay.
And I thought about going to makeup school. I thought about going to cinema and like different special effects type of schooling. But I, again, just couldn't afford it. And it really was out of my range. in what I thought I could do.
Yeah.
And so I just kind of kept playing with it on my own.
Sure.
And I've had some great mentors the last couple of years that have seen my potential and kind of brought me in and helped me out with some stuff that I'm like, oh, that's cool. You can do it that way. And then, of course, YouTube now.
It's incredible.
You can learn anything.
Right?
University of YouTube. Yeah.
It's the democratization of knowledge dissemination, right?
Yeah.
It's really wild.
Yeah.
And also with the technology too. I mean, you know, being able to do a podcast or people do web series or whatever.
Right.
And you can take a passion and just convert it into something.
Right.
Which you couldn't do as easily 20 years ago or even, I guess, 10 years ago, really.
No, exactly.
Yeah. When you said, you mentioned your economic situation. Mm-hmm. What was it sort of generally?
Always low income. Mm-hmm. I was an only child in a single parent household. My mom, who already had multiple disabilities. She was born legally blind. She's partially deaf. She had heart problems and feet problems and kind of always struggled. But she was proud enough to make sure that she was doing things on her own without trying to ask for too much help outside from government financial assistance. We lived on Section 8.
Mm-hmm.
We did get like government aided things, but she still worked under the table, cleaning mm-hmm. houses and ironing shirts and doing all these things just to try to give me anything, because she taught me how to read before I was in kindergarten. She gave me all the advantages that she didn't have.
Yeah, sure.
So she was always encouraging me and taking me on like a 2-hour bus ride to the center of LA just so I can go take this class, because she saw, oh, you can draw. Let's go see if we could encourage this or...
Yeah.
All these amazing things that she was always trying to just give me. And that was her work ethic, was just to do that. So, but it was always low income in general, and living next to our grandparents mm-hmm. and having them drive us around if we couldn't take the bus somewhere.
Right.
Yeah.
And it does limit your at least imagined possibilities.
Yeah.
Right. Because I know that the feeling when you just feel like, oh, I can't do that, or mm-hmm. like I can't, or to go to college, oh, well, my grades aren't great, and I don't know if that's going to work with my family's income and all that stuff. It's great that, you know, you found a way through into the thing
mm-hmm.
that you like. And also, it's such an amazing story to hear of your mom.
Yeah.
To have so much of a burden on herself
mm-hmm.
and to still push through, I can only imagine how devastated you were when she passed.
I was, but at the same time, I was trying to figure out my own sexuality. I was coming out of the closet when she was dying. And
so you're just dealing with like a couple things.
You know, I've been not much going on, you know?
Yeah, it was like a real like light kind of sketch.
And I was her caregiver, but I was really putting up a lot of walls.
Uh-huh.
And I didn't know how to deal with what I was going through. So I just put up a shit ton of thick ass walls. And
what did those walls look like?
Oh, they were brick. I couldn't hear shit. They were soundproof.
Poured concrete around.
Poured concrete. Yeah. With egg carton layers just to make sure that everything got bounced out. They were really, really thick and really emotionally blocking everything. So nothing was really breaking through. And so I didn't understand my loss of her until after it was all done, and then it all just kind of came flooding in, and I kept those walls up even further and pushed myself away from all my friends, all my family, and pretty much hid in my one bedroom apartment that I found in a hurry, having mm-hmm. to move out of our house, the apartment that we shared together, and focused on work.
Yeah. And what was work at the time?
At the time, I was working at a flower shop and a restaurant. I was serving at a Marie Callender's.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I was just working all day, working the morning shift, going home, taking a nap, falling asleep to Drop Dead Gorgeous on repeat. And then getting up, getting ready, going to the clubs, trying to pick up on girls that was never successful, and then coming home and then repeat every day. That was all I was doing, like every day.
That's the tenacity though, already there, right?
Never gave up.
Like even when we're in our most emotionally broken states,
uh-huh.
You can look back and see these weird patterns and you're like, I kept doing that. I kept doing that too.
Wow. Yeah.
So you were still struggling to come out at the time when you were going to the clubs? Were you feeling things out, or do I have the timeline off?
No, I was struggling to come out when she was dying.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. And how dare you not know that?
And, oh, God. She said one more, and then that's it.
Right? Yeah.
She's walking out.
And by the end, I pretty much already knew I was a lesbian, and I had my family already figured it out, too. And I had a really weird forced coming out.
Oh, no.
Moment at the hospital.
At the hospital? Oh, God.
And I know, and as an adult that has gone through many, many phases, I recognize that the intentions were probably much better than how I interpreted them.
Yeah, sure.
But at the moment, I was even like, what? So my mom had surgery, her final surgery, and they opened her up and then they just closed her back up because it was everywhere, the cancer. It was everywhere. There's nothing else they could do.
Yeah.
So they just closed her back up and then they told us, you just make her comfortable.
Yeah.
And I had my head down after receiving that information, and my Nina, my godmother, came up to me and she expected me to raise my head and be a mess. And I was just normal. I was, you know, my walls were up.
Sure, yeah. And also, I imagine shock and all of that.
All the emotions that I recognize now. In the moment, I thought I look like a spoiled brat. And
but also, what age again?
21.
That's a lot.
It's a lot.
At any age, but especially 21.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, but I still recognize I look like a spoiled brat.
It's okay, fair. I can't argue with you.
And so she took me outside to the little garden, zen area that they had at the hospital. And she just asked me if I had anyone that I could talk to. And I said, yeah. And then she asked if it was a woman. And I said, yeah. And then she said, are you having lesbian tendencies? And I just looked at her and I thought, I'm not sure. It's always the first thing. I pretended I was bi for a minute for 2 seconds. I never even had a real experience with a man, so I don't know why I thought I was bi. But
well, because for some reason we all think that
societally we're trained that that's what we're supposed to be.
Yeah, we're factory issued as
exactly. And then she just kind of we went on, and then that word got out to all of the immediate people in our lives, including my mom's best friends, and who was also our landlord, and I was also helping them on the side for extra money by helping them organize and collect their rent. So I was kind of working at their office sometimes too, and they encouraged me not to come out to her because of many reasons, and I didn't, and I still am okay with that because she already knew that I was putting up all these walls, and then I was alone because of all these walls. And so she knew that I was going to be going through this experience and walking my life alone.
Sure.
And she already was very saddened by that and very concerned by that. So we all agreed that I wouldn't tell her about it because then it would just be one more added stress that she didn't need.
Sure.
Why?
And it's your decision.
And it's my decision.
Yeah.
But I'm still completely, some people regret not telling their parents these important things, but I don't. I completely still embrace that decision. Yeah. And know that, recognize that now she knows and she always has known and she loves me no matter what. And is proud of me. So, in whatever form she has now, whatever space of energy she takes up or light or whatever she's evolved into, whatever her spirit is now, I know that she's my biggest fan and that loudest audience member or that energy that I feel after a show, that post-show adrenaline rush, I always I feel like it's her somehow coming through going, hey, you did a good job. They're like, yeah, proud of you.
So. And we mentioned in the hallway, the endless hallway.
The endless hallway. If you ever come to the studio, man, it is just an endless hallway. I was like, is this The Shining somehow?
I should probably video a couple times when I'm like, no, just through one more door. No, just one more after that. I promise. No. And also, they redid the floors, so my shoes are incredibly loud. They already were loud, but now it's just this clack, clack, clack. Yeah, I took a recording. I'll throw it in so the listeners can know what that sounds like. Yeah, but in the hallway, we were talking about how energy is a big thing for both of us, and especially as exemplified by what you just said. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned it a few times on Dragula.
I have, yeah.
Do you know when you started thinking about things in terms of energy and a sort of spiritual way? Because sometimes people think of things in a religious way. I prefer to think of things in energy. So I'm curious about when you started to think about things like that.
Well, I was born and raised a Catholic, but we didn't really practice much. Mm-hmm. And then I decided to be closer with my circle of friends, and they were Christian. And I'm like, oh, this is, we were part of like the Cardinals For Christ club at school.
Oh,
like,
wow.
Total geek, total nerd. I was in band, I was in drama. I was just like way out there.
And what did you play in band?
Clarinet.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. Yeah. So that was fun.
Do you still play at all?
No, it was a rental from the school. Okay. And so I just gave it back on my last day and I never touched one again.
I remember my
first... It was like my life too. And I was like, okay, no, okay, moving on.
Isn't it funny? Sometimes things would be completely consuming and then, oh, gone. Yeah. I remember accidentally selecting at very early age, some like second or third grade, they had this list of instruments that you could pick. And I picked recorder because I thought it actually meant tape recorder because I was, you know, like always an audio nerd.
Yeah, yeah, that's cute.
But then when they showed me what it was, I was like, oh, I don't want that. Uh-huh. Yeah. But anyway, so you were in band and you were in Cardinals For Christ?
Cardinals For Christ. Fuck me. And then when my mom was passing away, our landlord, who I just spoke of, they were Mormon. And they would always offer, if we ever wanted to like hang out or have the I'm already brain farting.
Is it like scriptures or what is it called?
The Mormonism?
Oh, or, yeah. No, the thing. I was just trying to.
Oh, what the word I couldn't think of? No, the missionaries.
Oh, yeah.
Come over and like teach you about religion, what would be happy to. And they were always respectful that we didn't want it. And then I was searching for something. I didn't know I was gay yet. My mom was sick. What's going on? And then.
It's kind of a struggle to just get through the day.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And then so I thought, oh, that's what I needed. I needed to be Mormon.
Right.
That's, it was just perfect timing.
Sure.
And my imagination thought that that was the right thing for me. So I was Mormon for a hot minute. And then everything, my whole life kind of switched when she passed away and I was coming out and I was searching for how to deal with myself. And right before I got diagnosed with my own oral cancer, which was in 2009, probably around 2006 or 2007-ish, I read The Alchemist and it blew my mind that the suggestion of a human being able to, with the power of mind and spiritual control, can alter or shift matter.
Right.
And it seemed like a fantasy and fiction, but at the same time, it was presented in such a real way that I thought there's something here. Mm-hmm. And then when I got sick, I picked up You Can Heal Your Life.
Okay, well now what's that?
By Louise Hay, I believe is her name. And it's a book about manifesting your own health and figuring out spiritually where your health issues are coming from and where the root of that particular health. Like this, if you have problems with your eyesight or something, that probably has to do with this mentality or memory of this moment, and then that is triggering that in your health. So if you work on the root of that, then you can change and alter your health.
Okay.
And she healed herself from cancer.
Oh wow!
With her own amazing willpower.
Sure.
And people think it's bullshit. And people, of course, you can have a lot of people who don't that, but I chose to believe it, and I chose to go down a beautifully winding road of metaphysical type of research and figuring out how that is. And after reading lots of different versions of lots of different things, I just decided to believe in my own, what made sense to me. And it's just, I have energy. I want to give it to those that I want to give it to. I'm not going to waste it on people who don't. And we're connected to every single thing on this planet, to each other, to the animals, to inanimate objects. Mm-hmm. We're all connected somehow.
Yeah.
And different strengths and different waves keep a stronger bond. And that's just general how I believe things now. And I don't know what is that called. I don't know, but I know that's what I believe.
I would just call it like spiritual.
Yeah.
And
because I do believe in spirits. I believe that, you know, I believe ghosts can exist. I believe that, you know, all these different things can exist because why not?
Right. Unless you can disprove it. There's no way. You can't say no.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A lot of people can say things like, I don't want to give people my energy if they don't deserve it.
Yeah.
But you can actually do that.
Yeah.
You know, and you can see that in Dragula, you're the only person that never really had a conflict with anyone. And a couple times, you know, you can see maybe you're have a sort of look on your face like, yeah, I wish this wasn't going on right now.
Yeah.
However, I am not part of it. I will not get involved in it.
Exactly.
That sort of thing.
Yeah. And that's kind of how I lived my life for a very long time now, since I've evolved into this place, at least. Because I used to give negativity to a lot, and I used to find a fondness in
the comfort
in making people feel dumb or putting people in their places and being like a mean-spirited person. Mm-hmm. And I used to find humor in that and just kind of give into all that and then pursue it. And I don't like being that person. That's those are the first things that come to my head. Like when all the drama's going on, the first thing that comes to my mind is like, ooh, I joined in on that. And then I think
I saw that.
No,
that's what I saw wash over your face.
I'm better than that. Not that I'm better than them. I mean, well, I won, but but you know, like I just, people deal with everything their own way. And sometimes it comes off as immaturity. Sometimes it just comes off on that's how you deal with things. And none of that interested me. I didn't come to the show to be a part of that. And I know reality TV is hugely a part of that, you know,
sure.
But I wasn't going to give into it. And if someone really said something or pushed me in my corner, I have all the ability to be able to fight for myself and fight back and bite back. But I choose not to.
And I have a feeling, too, that because of the way that you live your life and the energy that you output, no one was going to come for
you. I don't often receive it anymore. And I always have this, even when we were prepping for everything to come out and the episodes to start airing, and my memories of how what this happened, what that happened. Oh, man, what are they going to think? What is the audience going to think about this? You're going to tear me apart for that. I was preparing myself to receive some of that and didn't have it happen at once. Not
it's
even
amazing,
once.
Isn't
so,
that?
Yeah, it was really, really nice because I was stressed the fuck out for no reason.
But we can do that to ourselves, right? Like we can put ourselves into these insane, I guess, paranoid tunnels.
Mm-hmm.
And it's weird too because you feel like you can't talk to someone about it.
Yeah.
Because you're like, I'm going to sound nuts.
Yeah.
And then you further make yourself nuttier.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then it's like, you know, can't sleep.
And we signed a contract that we couldn't talk to anyone about it. So
that's the double whammy.
I don't want to get sued.
Right. Even better.
I know.
What age do you think that it finally clicked in? You read the alchemy book and then you go through that whole journey of reading and learning.
Mm-hmm.
And do you remember a time where you just sort of felt it applying?
No, I don't remember a moment because I still I fight with positive thinking a lot. When I was sick, I was going through it very easily, actually. So like I said, when I was sick, I was living in that space and I was refusing to give in to anything. And I would have moments of fear and sadness and that would overwhelm me, especially towards the end of my treatment. I was in excruciating pain. I could no longer talk. The pain was so much where I could barely even drink like half of an Ensure, which is my entire nutrient like base. Even through those moments, all I could do was, okay, well, let me write more notes to my doctor and ask some more questions and think of how can I take this moment. And I even had, I anticipated myself lying down a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So before I got too sick, I research a bunch of positive mantras and things that would be good for me to remember. And I wrote them out on pieces of paper and made them colorful and in my like detail oriented way. And I tacked them to my ceiling above my my bed. And I would just lie there and look at these things all day long and try to just ingrain that. And so I think that really worked. And I committed myself to MySpace at the time.
Oh, yes, of course.
MySpace. Yeah. I was public about my journey.
Mm-hmm.
And I told them that every day I was going to put out a positive thought.
Mm-hmm.
And so I did. And I would find something, either research or in whatever book I was reading at the moment.
Yeah.
And then like, oh, that speaks to me right now. Let me put that up. And then so I would go online and put my little positive thinking moment. And I think karmically speaking, and I'm still receiving a lot of that regularly.
I imagine. And also that's a really great lesson too for anyone that might be struggling with something. Apply a daily practice.
Yeah.
And an intentioned thing, right?
Yeah.
And also a mood board doesn't hurt.
A mood board, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Again, visually stimulating.
Right.
Yeah. And also the daily fight against the negativity, because it would be very easy at that point in your life, you know, having gone through what you've gone through and then getting sick yourself, mm-hmm. some people would just collapse.
Yeah.
So it's remarkable.
Thank you. Yeah. And I feel like I was just taught all these things from my mom's spirit. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate when people compliment or congratulate me mm-hmm. on getting it done the way I did, mm-hmm. but it never seemed hard. It wasn't difficult. So it's weird for me to accept that praise or congratulations. Sure. 'Cause I'm like, well, it was easy almost. And mm-hmm. Other people, it's not. And so right. I feel like they deserve the praise more than I did. 'Cause they're like, oh, this is what I did. I don't know. I just did it. So, I mean, I just made the decision and continued to do it. And that was when I was in my most zen kind of always positive, always playing it by that. And then I get jaded and now I'm fine. And now I'm just like yelling at people when I'm in traffic. You know?
So do you find you get the jaded thing? It comes in waves?
It does. It does. And I try to practice, but not the way I used to. I used to be very committed. And now I'm just... I think I found like a balance where I don't need to practice it as much as I did, but there are moments where, okay, I need to do some soul searching again, or I got to get back into it.
And it's okay to have the pendulum swing back and forth because at the time you really had to be hypervigilant. Mm-hmm. You know, it was like the only way
and
out.
And it's the only thing I had to do.
Yeah.
I was just lying around doing nothing. Mm-hmm. So might as well do something.
Right. And you have to occupy your mind.
Exactly.
And something's going to occupy it. So you might as well. Yeah. You know, that's the other
true.
Thing.
True. Uh-huh. I watched a lot of TV.
What, did you get into any shows in particular in that time?
During that time? No, I don't remember. I watched all my DVDs again. So. Uh-huh. Drop the Gorgeous again was on repeat.
Sure.
And then
is that your favorite movie?
It's one of, I would say, like that one I could definitely, I was relating to my life a lot. It's uh-huh. just stupid. Well, I love stupid so much.
Well, it's stupid, but there's also there is some deep things going on in that movie.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean,
there's a lot. There's like there's intense aspiration and fighting against the structures that be, the powers uh-huh. that be,
yes.
and everything. The Kirstie Alley character representing all the monsters.
Oh, and, yes. And like a ridiculous kind of a political commentary on like America.
Yeah.
And over again, every year it has to be something about America. It's like, yeah, okay. <right. laughs>
And also the casual misogyny of her husband.
Uh-huh.
All that stuff.
All of it. There's so much. And that's what I love about stupid, because I love, even for myself, I explain that I take my stupidity very seriously. And I love like anything that takes stupidity seriously, I'm all about it.
Oh, I love it.
I love it. Yeah. There's so much intelligence in stupidity.
Yeah, when it's
on purpose.
Yeah, no, totally. Yeah, yeah. No, when it's just something's dumb, then it's dumb. Stupidity, however, is an elevated level of what
really,
I'm thinking.
It really is.
What are a couple other favorite movies of yours?
Oh, Drop Dead Gorgeous.
Yeah. That counts for two, I think.
Okay, I like it. another one that I'm trying to think of?
And take your time, too, because this question is always awful, because it puts you on the spot. I've been asked this question. I blank out totally.
And I don't have favorites.
That's why I have the posters on the wall, so I can go, oh, The Live and Die in LA, Tommy, Hedwig.
You do have a lot of posters. I'm like, ooh, there's a lot of good references here. But yeah, I don't. It's very hard for me to have favorites in anything.
Okay,
any,
sure.
Any color, any food, anything like that.
Right. Yeah, well, except for avocados. Those are not your jam, right?
Not my jam. God, that's funny that you know that. Yeah, my whole hashtag avocado channel.
I love to deep dive, you know, and I love to find out food stuff especially.
Okay. I love it. So, I mean, I guess horror will probably be Nightmare on Elm Street.
Oh, yeah. And I just saw two for the first time in 30 years uh-huh. at the New Beverly recently, which was wild to see, because I only saw it when it came out on tape.
Yeah.
And I didn't really like it as a kid. I love three. I love the first one.
Okay. The first one was my favorite.
Yeah.
And then the one where, see, against the subtitles.
Just describe it, because like, this is my, I love it. I love
the gay one, but I love the Dream Warriors.
Yeah.
For some reason, that was when I was like, oh, this stupidity, I love it. And it was like much more fantastical and much more, sure. I think, like dark or like goth or
totally. Yeah, no, that one goes really like off into these worlds. Yeah.
And the imagination. And I think the whole series is what I love about the whole series, is that you're going to be surprised by it, because it's the imagination of nightmares.
Yes.
And nightmares can take any shape or form,
exactly.
any format, and it can be dumb, or it can be crazy, gross, and intense, and gory. And I love the dynamics of all of those things all in one movie. So, and every movie has all different things.
Yeah, it goes in every direction, and it's fine because that's the sort of premise. That those are the rules that they set up for.
Yeah. And I think that's probably the whole series is why I love it. But those two are one of my favorites of the series, and I like Gremlins.
Oh, Gremlins is great.
Yeah.
I think it's showing as a matinee sometime soon in the New Beverly.
Oh, okay.
So I'll let you know about that. Yeah, it'd be fun to see that. And Biqtch Puddin is doing a spoof.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, Femlins.
I saw that on Michael's page and I was obsessed. And then I looked and then I went back. I'm like, oh my God, I love it. I love this concept. I love all the performers in it. I wish I could see it. I want to go up there just to watch
it. You should. I'm going to go with Cherry and Sophie and stuff.
I'm jealous of you because I can't. But yeah.
Well, maybe it'll come to LA next year. I don't know.
Something will happen where I can see it because... Yeah. I'm so excited that is coming to an existence.
Yeah. Do you like the sequel, the new batch?
I like the first one better.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That's to me is just the...
It's a classic.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's unbeatable.
Yeah. So dumb. some of the themes are just like so funny. Stripe was my favorite. Mm-hmm. But other than that... I don't know. I can't think of any, but I'll probably think of other movies.
Oh no, when they come to you. Yeah. You know, as we go, we drift around on the show.
Yeah.
So when you were performing at Hamburger Mary's, you had the first performances that you told me about. Mm-hmm. How much planning and preparation went into that first one?
I was practicing my makeup multiple times a week.
Wow.
For a few months. And I was, don't half-ass things really.
No,
and
that I know. Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Right. Yeah. By the way, if you vape weed, you feel free to vape weed because sometimes I forget to mention it and I'm constantly vaping.
Thank
this
you.
Thing,
yeah, so. I have one in my pocket, so I'll dig it out in a minute.
Cool.
And also I was practicing multiple things. I would do half my face in one way and then I would do the other half in another way to try to like take full advantage of that makeup practice time.
Sure.
And I was applying facial hair a lot, trying to figure out what was the best way because at the time I didn't really have drag king scene to go out and watch. So I was just looking online and everything online was male illusion drag. So you wanted to pass as a man.
Okay.
And that was what the epitome of drag kings were. Were just old school style. Male illusion, male impersonation.
Okay.
And so I thought, oh, that's what I have to do too.
Who would be a few examples of, I guess, the preeminent male impersonators that you would have been looking at as a reference?
Gage Gatlin is a, like one of the original, that did the open shirt illusion.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And did my
number.
Yeah, exactly. Just like you right now. He's not wearing anything, guys. He welcomed me into the studio with a half button shirt and now it's just off. He's getting more comfortable. That vape pen is just working.
I'll be dressed again for the photo. You know, it's cool.
And you couldn't tell that I look amazing right now, too.
Oh, you're just stunning.
I am.
Yeah, absolutely.
My teeth have never been whiter.
Nor have mine. Yeah, exactly. It said you won't see that because we're going to put on a whole different outfit for the photos and stuff right now. But now I'm just gagging over her elegance.
I'm going to take about 5 hours to do my makeup for that photo. I forgot what I was saying.
Gage
Gatlin was a male impersonator. And then historically, I was looking at Stormé DeLarvere, which is like an iconic male illusionist from the Stonewall like riots. And before that, Hedy King. Mm-hmm. So they were always passable. And
to further distract us, I remember reading in an article, I think that you wrote for The Advocate.
I did.
About Stone. You mentioned Stonewall in it.
I did.
And you talk about...
Because of the historical moment that gets over, just brushed aside
and
all the time.
And I'd love for you to get into that now.
Well, we're always giving credit to the trans queens of color that were involved. And it's very rarely heard of that Stormé DeLarvere was the emceeing male illusion of the Jewel Box Review, which was the home cast of the show that was there all the time. He was the live singing MC.
Okay.
And he, during the whole momentum, and right in that moment, a policeman pushed him down and called him a faggot. Mm-hmm. And he got up and he punched the cop. And that's when people started to get crazy too.
Wow.
So it wasn't just a trans queen of color. It was also a trans, he wasn't trans. He was still a lesbian, I believe, passed away still identifying as a lesbian as far as I remember. But he was a color, person of color. And it's such a huge moment that, you know, I say, and it kind of sounds a little striking to some people when I say it, but the history that we know were written by men and men write women out of it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's unfortunate because since the beginning of time, women have been providers and has evolved a lot in artists and these and amazing, talented yeah. human beings and architects and sculptors and everything that we've always known men to do and that we only read about men.
Sure.
Women doing it just as talented and mm-hmm. just as skilled, but right. we never hear about them.
Right.
But we've been around. But so now we finally have social media and things to bring these things to light. And mm-hmm. everyone's like, oh, wow, first woman to do this. Like, no, just the first woman you knew about.
Right. Well, yeah. you know, that's the first time I knew about that specific aspect of Stonewall okay. was reading your article.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's if you once you research Stormy DeLarvey and Stonewall, you'll see it's been talked about.
Sure.
But it's just not ever brought up often enough to people have in the mainstream know about it.
Sure.
Or even in our own subcultures right. know about it. Yeah. Misogyny. Huh.
That crazy old misogyny.
Crazy misogyny.
Oh, it's so funny though. Don't we love it so?
Oh, so ironic.
So you were looking to these pioneers
yeah
and starting to form your idea of what you wanted to do
mm-hmm. and so I was still planning on performing comedy and all these crazy campy things too, but I thought I had to look like a man.
Sure.
Where if I was sitting next to them at the bar, they thought I was a man mm-hmm. until I opened my mouth and spoke.
Yeah.
And so that was my goal. So I was just practicing all the different ways that I can look as much like a man mm-hmm. as possible. And then my first performance, my tits popped out. But aside from that, yeah, it took me a long time of preparing, and I didn't know about mixing music, so I was teaching myself that too, and I was making these elaborate mixes. Oh, God.
Yeah. Well, very elaborate seems to be
something
your
that
thing.
I'm familiar with.
Yeah, exactly.
I know. And I have a huge love and admiration for simplistic, because some of the most simplistic things that you look at can take just as long as an elaborate thing
That's
to
true.
Paint.
Yeah.
But I wish that I could be more simple sometimes mm-hmm. with the things that I paint or create, just because I have a fondness for simplistic looks that I just can't. Like, I have to add details to
it. Oh, I know what you mean.
Yeah.
It's just certain things that you know, you're like, oh, I would love to do something like that. But yeah. like your inner nature just goes, well, over here.
That's why I'm going to,
add this little thing.
Yeah.
You know what? You need the teeth on that fleshlight. You know, which by the way, one of my favorite things on your finale, not your finale look, but your finale presentation.
Uh-huh.
That blew my mind, the vagina dentata
yeah.
flashlight.
Yeah. And that, those are all made by Monster Cox.
Oh, okay.
My friend works for my bromance, one of my best friends. Uh-huh. His name is Ivory Onyx. He's a drag king as well. And his wife is Caitlin. And Caitlin works for Real Doll Company, which makes full-size sex dolls. And they're one of their sub companies is called Monster Cox.
Mm-hmm.
And they were very kind enough to let me borrow all of those sex toys and that sex doll.
Wow.
$10,000 okay. sex doll.
Yeah.
That they didn't make me sign a contract to take care of it or anything. They just trusted me
yeah.
so much to take that on set with me. And I couldn't even tell them what it was for.
Oh, that's right.
So it wasn't like, I could be like, oh, it's this really cool show that's going to be like blow up the entire world and the concept yeah. of what drag is.
Yeah.
That's already been doing that for a couple of years. I couldn't even tell them like what
it was.
I just
have to go away for like a couple months.
I have this cool opportunity. I'm going to have it for a hot minute and then I'll give it back to you. And I swear it'll be okay.
What was the bullshit line that you would tell people about, like, I'm going to visit someone, or like, what was the thing you would say?
I didn't tell anyone anything.
I just
avoided the I just disappeared and then I came back because people follow me on social media so much, and they like, it's so hard to lie about that shit these days. And I know Eva told people that she was taking her grandma to Europe or something, and people were like, all right. Like, people picked up on it so
yeah,
soon.
Yeah, no, because everyone detects everything. It's true. And then there's the line of like, who do you tell and who do you not tell? Like,
right.
what's the cutoff line?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so better
yeah.
to just
my wife knew, but she technically yeah. shouldn't know, but still, like, she knew, because obviously.
Right, so technically she didn't know, right?
Yeah.
Like, just
yeah,
for
yeah.
legal reasons.
Yeah, for legal reasons she didn't know. But aside from that, it was all, if you can read between the lines, then that's on you.
Mm-hmm.
But most people, I didn't even give lines to read through. It was more like my main bosses, like the cast that I were a part of. Like, I'm going on some dragcation. And that's always the term that we use when girls are going on RuPaul.
Oh, sure.
So it was
yeah,
kind of
yeah.
like, I'm going on a dragcation and I'm going to need some time off.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully I'll have some spots open when I come back. Or I'm going to be going on vacation, on dragcation, so I need as many gigs as I can right now so I can like help fund my dragcation.
Yeah, right,
yeah.
right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so right before you went, what would your work week look like?
Before, it was a Tuesday in West Hollywood, a Wednesday in either San Diego or Long Beach, a Thursday in Long Beach, mm-hmm. a Friday in Long Beach or West Hollywood, two brunch shows on a Saturday, maybe a dinner show on a Saturday, and maybe like a 10 o'clock or like midnight show on a Saturday. So I would have like four shows. And then Sunday, it would be a double brunch on a Sunday and then maybe like a dinner show.
Mm-hmm. So then, very full week.
Yeah, hardly any work at all. Yeah.
Hey, this is DJ Fat Tony, and I've been listening to your show for a while now. I've got a question for you. Don't take it the wrong way, but are you gay? Because I always like to know if somebody's gay or not, because I kind of can't cope if you're not.
You mentioned your wife. When did you meet your wife?
2 weeks before I was diagnosed. Hmm. So it was very...
Again, a lot going on.
A lot going on, yeah, for that. There's always seems to be like, hey, here's the situation, but let's all put a lot of shit at the same time.
And it's funny, actually, Trixie, in that recent episode, we talk about this thing when you realize sort of being an adult, that there's a lot of great things and bad things happening concurrently. Hmm. It's a weird thing when you can just sort of see them fanned out like that. And you're like, okay, cool, like this bad thing doesn't mean that everything's rotten. And this great thing doesn't mean that everything's solved.
Right.
It's just, and you, well, I guess we're dealing with a lot of that intensely at the time.
Yes, yes. So I met her on my birthday, which is in June. Mm-hmm. June 14th of 2009, we met on MySpace.
Oh, great.
Yeah. And it was that day, that morning or something, we were chatting and she's like, what are you doing tonight? I'm like, oh, I'm just hanging out tonight at home. Mm-hmm. My birthday at midnight, if you want to come over and like give me a hug, like flirting, but not really, you know, because it was still like, come over, but let's be friends. Like, we're not trying to meet under like, let's date, you know, whatever. Sure. We exchange phone numbers. We like text each other within a couple hours. So it was very much quick. And then she came over that night and we watched... What did we watch?
Drop Dead Gorgeous?
No, I wish. I think we watched Sounds of the Lambs.
Oh, wow. What a romantic.
I know. That's actually one of my, great movie of
that
mine.
That is a great one. Did you ever see Manhunter?
No.
The first appearance of Hannibal Lecter is in a film is this Michael Mann movie called Manhunter, which I think the story is, the book is called Red Dragon, and later they remade it as Red Dragon?
Yes, they remade it as Red Dragon, but it was, there was original.
Yes.
Okay, I didn't watch the original, but I remember now knowing that.
I think you'd like it. I think you'd like it.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. My pleasure. Yeah. So anyway, you watched Silence of the Lambs.
Yes. and then the next day, my car... I'm like adding to the story. My car had recently caught on fire.
Oh, wow. How did it catch on fire?
Because I had another layer. I was healing from knee surgery. Uh-huh. I was playing roller derby because I'm that much of a lesbian. I was playing roller derby and I tore my ACL and I had knee surgery for it. And I was healing from that when I met my wife and then got diagnosed. So I was already like off from work for a while. Mm-hmm. And my car was a 69 Volkswagen Beetle.
Oh, wow.
And it needed to get turned over regularly. Mm-hmm. And I hadn't done it in a while.
Sure.
I got real lazy. And I couldn't use both my legs because it was just like a manual. And I just didn't do it. And so I finally was healed enough to drive. Mm-hmm. So I went to go, I took it to go get an oil change.
Yeah.
And as it was on the way to the oil change, it caught on fire.
Oh my God. Now, how do you start realizing it's on fire? Do you see flames or do you start smelling something?
It was flames. Yeah, it was flames in my rearview mirror because it was behind me.
Oh, great.
The engine's
that's
behind
right.
me.
And that's
I'm just
right.
like, doo-doo-doo. And I just like looked and yep, there they were. And I pulled over and I screamed for help. I was in a residential area.
Oh, no.
And a lady right next to the car was watering her backyard.
Uh-huh.
And she threw me the hose and I attempted to put it out, but it didn't work. And then the fire... A truck came and put it out and charged me like $3,000 to clean up the mess afterwards.
My God.
And then, and he was so cool. He was like, if you leave now, I think we can, if the tow truck comes right now, I think we can get it out of here and I don't have to have your like vehicle information on this form and then we won't have to charge you for it.
Oh, wow.
And they found out anyway somehow. I know, I forgot. But he was trying to be really cool with me.
Yeah, that's nice though. Yeah.
But yeah, I got charged for it anyway. So the next day I went to my roommates and I was like, I met this girl. I really think she's really, really fucking cool. And I want to go over and hang out with her. Can I borrow your car?
Yeah.
And I've never borrowed a car before. And then
certain things
it
will
just
make
kinda,
it do certain things.
I know. And then it just evolved. And I sat her down when I got my diagnosis and I told her what it was and what was happening and how much we didn't know what was going to happen.
Yeah.
And I had watched my mom pass away, so I know what could happen.
Sure.
And I gave her an out and I said, we just met. I don't expect you to take on this responsibility.
Yeah.
I will completely understand and 100% guarantee you that we can pick this up again where we left off, and I will hold no hard feelings because I know what this can look like.
Yeah.
And if you're not ready to go there with me, I don't want to like see you watch me go through that.
Sure.
You know, and then like, let me just throw that around. Wow, well, that's I'm throwing things at you now.
That's okay. And then my couch swallows things. So
it sure does.
Here, let me see. Let me get here. I'll put the phone light on. You know how many vapes I've dropped in this couch?
I got excited and I threw my vape head around. Oh, I think it like went real far.
Maybe the couch won't give it back.
Oh my God. What ended up happening is my ass ate it up. That is what you don't want to happen unless, you had a bottom experience. So you probably don't want to repeat.
Sometimes you want the ass to eat it up. You know what I mean?
I haven't been put in that situation where I wanted that to happen, so I don't know.
Oh, and, you know, and we'll get into that too, talking about...
About my ass eating
things
up?
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Ass eating, sexual stuff. I mean,
awesome.
You know, you did mention in Dragula when you had the reoccurrence of the oral cancer that, you know, it would have been real bad for leisure activities.
It is. Tongue cancer is a bitch for lesbians to have, for sure. But yeah, so then I gave her the out and she looked at me and was borderline, if not crossed the line to being offended that, wow, I gave her that out.
Sure.
And she said, of course not. I'm here by you. She knew that she loved me when she met me. Mm-hmm. Which is how she tells the story. And yeah. I like to believe it because why not?
Well, know? Right. Why would you want to disprove something like that, right? We're all for science, but please.
Right. I had already gone through a few procedures, uh-huh, where they weren't sure what my cancer was. So I was being treated for herpes, thinking that it was herpes. Oh. And then I kept going back and it was getting more painful and I couldn't move my neck. And I was like, this is like a lot. This is all my research I'm doing about herpes. This is the same line I've been experiencing.
It's just not lining up.
So finally, they suggested another specialist and then he did a biopsy and then they didn't want to believe that I was, it was cancer because I was young oral cancer. I never smoked. I wasn't a heavy drinker outside of like the year that I was going to the clubs. Like
sure.
So it didn't make sense for them. So they didn't believe me. So they kept sending it back to get retested. Mm-hmm. And it was during all those retesting that I met my wife. So I was already starting to put up these walls myself.
Yeah.
So I was trying to convince myself that I wasn't falling in love with her, but I was. And so she refused to give up on me or leave my side. And she would drive from Van Nuys to Long Beach almost every day.
Wow.
After work.
Yeah.
Just to come and hang out with me. And then when I got really sick, I would make her not come like a couple days just to take a break and like stay at home and be with her cats and like do something different than just like be miserable with me. And then so she came after a couple days and she said that I looked like I had like lost like 20 pounds in those few days. So then after that, she stopped taking breaks and she just wanted to be by myself all the time.
It is really sweet though that the two of you were trying to basically take care of each other, in whatever way. Like, just don't you stay home. I want you here, but please
don't
stay home.
Don't drive again. Like, you're just driving like 8 hours a day. Come see me.
Yeah. It is an amazing thing. Sometimes you do feel something with someone that you just met. I'm sure at the time you said like you didn't want to believe that that was happening.
Right.
Right. But there must have been something that was like in the back of your mind, like, oh yeah, there's something here.
That's why I went to my roommates on that second day. I'm like, I met this girl. I like her. I really want to borrow your car. Yeah. And then a couple of days later, I was telling other friends about her. Like, this girl's really special, but I still hadn't like given any hints of that to her yet. We were still playing it friendly and just casual. And it took us like a couple of weeks to kiss. And then that was like right before I was like, no, this is a whole thing. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, what were you like in dating before that? Would you be quick on the draw?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I had 3 girlfriends and they all cheated on me in different ways. Mm-hmm. And like some were actual like sleeping with someone else during our entire relationship. And then there are other ways where it was like online. And another one was like a physical like kiss or something. But so I had a moment of different levels of cheating.
You got to experience this fun spectrum of cheating.
Great. Yeah, but I never went into the next relationship assuming or with guards up. I still went, well, what was that person?
Sure.
And other people don't cheat. I don't cheat. So maybe I'm just going to meet this person that's not going to cheat too.
And, well, again, that's, you know, positive approach to things. And also, what do you think is worse in from all of those, the emotional cheating or the physical cheating?
Well, the emotional one was my first girlfriend. So that one was like way more intense.
Yes, but first girlfriend.
Yeah.
Especially
that. And that was the longest relationship. I think we were together for like 4 months.
Listen, long and short is relative.
Yeah. And then the other ones were just like a month or month or two. Yeah. But still, you know. Just break up with me first before you cheat. People have been together for a couple months. Fuck. It's really that hard.
I had a long protracted deception situation where I was with the one being deceived. Yeah. And you kind of later, you're just like, you know, you could have just said like, hey, like, let's call this a day.
Yeah.
Or like
it would have hurt, but as much as it did, like, that you're fucking around.
And this like long, bizarro, like icy, strange, like lots of weird, like, oh, I can't sleep thinking about that again kind of thing.
Yeah. So funny.
But so then when you meet, what's your wife's name?
Gabi.
So when you meet Gabi, you feel differently than you felt before.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very sweet the way you just said that.
Oh. Yeah. See, when you have on TV, you won't see it, you know?
So then you're dealing with the cancer. And what was the official diagnosis that they gave you? Is it just oral cancer? Or
Squamous cell carcinoma.
Oh, right. Okay. That's right. You mentioned that on the show.
It's okay. Yeah. It's the inner lining of the mouth and throat into the top of this stomach. It's,
oh, wow.
So anything within that layer is called squamous cell. Okay. And mine presented itself on the back of my tongue as like a sore.
Oh, okay.
And then it just got bigger and bigger.
What's the thing you would recommend if people should look out for in that situation, like with a sore in their mouth or anything like that? Is there any kind of warning sign that people should look out for?
Well, I mean, it's for me and my personal experience, it was like a painful canker sore that kept getting bigger, and it felt like it was attaching itself to deeper things that were like affecting into my neck and my head.
Yeah.
And so But the biggest recommendation I can give anyone facing anything that there's a mystery or they're unsure of, or even if there is a clear-cut answer, is to do a lot of your own research.
Sure.
Just constantly be looking things up and have lists of questions for your doctors and your medical staff, because they're just going to give you the easy way out. They're kind of probably just going to shuffle some chemical medicine at you that you're just going to say, okay, thank you, take it, and just assume it works. But it may not work, or there might be another, like, something that you can do for it, or just more answers you can get that will give you a different regime to follow.
Sure.
And it's just regimen. That was wrong.
Well, no, regime works
regime
too.
Regime works too. Yeah. Okay.
And it's more military, right?
It is, yeah. Because you know me and my military background. I was in a military marching band. So.
Oh, there you go. That's right. So it's all tying together.
All back at the beginning. Yeah, but after I took that hit, the word regime sounded really weird.
What strain do you like?
This is an indica hybrid. I like indica hybrids. Mm-hmm. I used to do sativas, but it started to give me anxiety.
Oh, okay, sure.
Yeah. My finale of smoking sativa was I had a really bad anxiety attack, and it was the worst I've ever had. I've only had like a couple here and there throughout my life. I have like a stream of anxiety that flows in and out, but it's just kind of like a flow, especially during we're waiting for the announcement of the winner. I had everyday anxiety for like a month, but I had like actual panic attack, and I was in the bathroom on the floor in fetal position, and I called out for my wife, and it was like 3 o'clock in the morning, and she came into the bathroom. She found me, and she's like, "Oh no, what's going on?" I'm like, "Oh, I'm having a panic attack. I got too high." And so she sang. She just cuddled me, and she sang to me one of Linda Belcher's songs from Bob's Burgers.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And she was just singing. I forgot what song it is now. She can tell you. She remembers. But she was just singing it to me, and then she kind of laughed at herself. I'm like, no, keep singing. It makes me feel better. So she just kept singing Linda Belcher's songs.
That's adorable. That's so sweet.
She keeps singing.
Yeah.
So, and that was the last time. And ever since then, I've switched to indica or indica hybrids. calms me down.
Okay.
Especially to perform, it slows me down.
Yeah.
I'm a better performer. I'm a better actor when I'm high.
Okay.
Because I give like subtleties.
Sure.
More than when I'm just like, oh, hurry up, get through it.
Because you can slow things down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because it seems like your mind is running at a very fast clip all the time.
Yes.
Yeah. And that can play hell with anxiety too, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, you said this sometimes there's a steady stream of anxiety. So do you mean sort of like it's like the babbling brook that you know is there, but you just don't let it pour out onto mainland?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So I don't need to medicate it. I don't need to really put much awareness into it. It's at the back end of things enough, but sometimes, and it's more because of trying to keep up with what people expect of me. So that's where that kind of anxiety is rooted in.
Mm-hmm.
And it comes up in different waves and then falls back and sometimes isn't there. But mm-hmm. a lot more recently, it's there a little bit more often.
So do you find that sometimes with great success and excitement, sometimes the anxiety, the sort of the dark stuff flares up?
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. And I try not to think of it as dark because it could be something that is like, will just fuel. Because if I do fall into a dark place, I get just lazy and don't do shit.
Okay.
And I don't, this is not the time for me to not do shit. And I went through a bout of that actually, like after being announced as a winner, I was just like, I'm overwhelmed. Like we're talking about being overwhelmed by kindness and support. It's such a weird thing to be like,
that's right. In the hallway, the endless hallway. We were talking again about,
we talked about the endlessness of the hallway and the endlessness of beautiful support that sometimes is like, I don't know what to do with it at all.
I didn't know there was this much out there and I don't have space in my apartment for this. It's like Costco size amounts.
It is. And it's so beautiful and like and I would describe it without going into detail as I am now to the background of it, but I would describe it as being overwhelmed in the most magical way.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's so much, it's beauty and it's love and it's support and it's compliments. Who doesn't like getting complimented? But it was just so much, I didn't know how to deal with it or what to do with it.
Yeah.
And then there was an expectation of success and
enjoying the success too.
And trying to enjoy it.
I mean the expectation that you're supposed to be like, I'm supposed to be the happiest person in the world right now.
And I was struggling because it was there. It was just this underlying anxiety that I was like trying to keep down, but it sometimes it's bubble up and then they're like, why am I crying? I don't know why I'm crying. It's not even,
I always think of that stuff as like a pot that's boiling on the stove and you're kind of like in the other room and you're like, I gotta go check that. And you know it's about to boil over.
Right.
And like, but like somehow you have to keep it from everyone else at the dinner party.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And like weirdly you can't talk about it.
That's a good analogy. I like that. But it came because of, I stayed away from Reddit. I don't read it.
You have to stay away from Reddit.
I stay away from it. But other people don't. And so sometimes I get like screenshots or things like that that come my way. And it was all beautiful, nice, supportive things. And other people that do read Reddit, they told me that I was showered with endless amount of support on that site. And what I was seeing on my own posts, what I was seeing on like the Boulay Brothers posts on Instagram, other social media that I follow, it was all so beautifully supportive for myself and so much that I kept getting more and more and more. And then people would expect from every episode Glenn's going to kill it. And then whatever the case may be. And luckily I did. But but there are moments that you film that you're like, oh my God, I wonder if they're going to keep that in or that critique or whatever. And then I'm going to be read for that. So it was, you know, the anxiety of being out of control of all of that. Because I'm in control of all my art, but I'm not in control of how it's being edited or like, or taken by a TV audience, especially because I perform in a different way than it was just for TV. And I wasn't giving into the TV format of things.
Yeah, no, exactly. You didn't have it mapped out for the kind of shots. And also the show is shot in a different way. It's not just a straight documentary style, capturing of the performance.
Right.
There's an interpretation with the editing, et cetera.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, is control a big thing for you outside of the art?
Outside of the art, not much. I do like having communication.
Okay.
I really appreciate lines of communication.
Sure. Me too. I'm very into like information. I like, you know, emotional information and that kind of stuff.
Connect with me somehow to let me know what to expect on this or whatever. Like, I don't need to be in control of it. I just need to know that there's some kind of communication coming towards me for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. But when it comes to how people perceive my art or get edited, that's when I was like, what's going to happen and how is this going to like go down? Or
especially because up to this point, you were the only editor, really, of it.
Yeah, exactly. And I make my own music mixes and I design my own looks. And
so you still do the music mixes all yourself?
Yeah.
That's great. You know what? And we might be going off track, but that's the show. I loved that you brought snacks for everyone on that one episode.
I brought snacks.
Didn't you? Or, I mean, hopefully I'm not misremembering something or hallucinating.
I might have, but I don't remember.
Yeah, you had snacks for people. And you know what? So because of that, I got some snacks for you.
I'll take the snacks, but I don't remember doing giving snacks.
I got some pastries from Cake Monkey, if you'd like.
I gave so many snacks to people to deserve this.
Yes, you did.
I don't remember I know I did.
I could have sworn you did. Now, I'll have to go find the thing and then pull a clip of it.
And then prove me wrong, because I'll be like, oh, yeah, no, I write it.
I hope so, because otherwise I'll be proving myself wrong.
I don't think but I love snacks.
Yeah, let me go. I'll go grab them. One sec.
Wow, I'm intrigued.
Now, this is me being restrained, because if I have
only eat half of it.
Well, I know. I'm sorry. I did. But
there's
another. That's the Enough Said cookie, which is my favorite thing. That's why I couldn't hold back. And then this is their pumpkin chocolate cookie. So, and then also there's these two little cakes here that
they look like ding dongs.
They're kind of like reimagined ding dongs.
I love that.
And they're raspberry red velvet. So we can pause for a second too and just enjoy some cake if you'd like. Okay, cool.
Let me take another hit in my vape pen.
Yeah definitely,
for sure.
That's what reminded me. I had them on the tray and I put them out there so I wouldn't forget.
I'm so down.
Okay, perfect.
Hold please.
Yes, we'll be back in a moment after enjoying some lovely Cake Monkey pastries. Thanks everybody. Part two of my chat with Landon coming soon. In the meantime, feast on all the delightful content available at patreon.com/craigandfriends.